Sir, can we start?
Yes, yeah, we got started.
Okay. Good evening,
Yes,
everyone. A warm welcome to today's webinar on inertial navigation on aerospace, organized by the Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering, Luth Mada College of Science and Technology, Kutichel, Trivandrum. I would like to introduce speaker of the day, Dr. P.P. Mohanlal, Principal, Luth Mada College of Science and Technology. He is a former director in ISRO Inertial System Unit. He is also elected as a fellow of Indian National Academy of Engineering. Before I hand over the presentation to the speaker, I request all the participants to mute the audio and video to avoid any distractions. Thank you all. Over to the speaker, sir.
Good afternoon to all of you. I welcome on behalf of Luth Mada College of Science and Technology, all the participants, all the students within Luth Mada College and from other colleges like Amal Jyoti, IIST and other colleges. I welcome all the some of the faculty members who are joining from within the college and outside for this talk. And also the organizers, the Electronics and Communication Department of Luth Mada College of Science and Technology, thank the department for giving me this opportunity to give this talk. Now, this particular subject, I had been working for many years on this. Are you able to? I've been working on this inertial navigation systems for aerospace, particularly for rocketry, for launching spacecrafts. And also that experience what I have gained, then had a stint of 2 years of academics in Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology, where I was teaching the inertial navigation systems and sensors plus the satellite navigation in totality as a course for the BTech. So that is the background. So what I want to say about this particular thing is that it is interdisciplinary. It can be attended by any branch of engineering because it requires little bit of mathematics what you already studied in school and early college days, and then some common sense, etc. When coming to the sensors, the technology is very advanced, so we are not straight away going into the technology. The first lecture will assume that the measurement sensors are available, and we will focus on the starter, the background for building up the algorithm, and that is little involved. Once we complete that, we will gradually, the plan is to have a lecture series every week, 1 hour lecture spanning over approximately a year or maybe 10 months or so, so that we can deliver the full course in full detail and for the benefit of the audience. So here I go. Let's say navigation. What is navigation? We define the navigation of any vehicle, whether it be a launch vehicle or an aircraft or a helicopter or any user vehicle, for that example, it can be anything, to know the position vector, I stress vector, position vector, the velocity vector, and the orientation. What is orientation, or otherwise called attitude of the user, which constantly undergoing 6 degrees of motion. What is this 6 degrees of motion? Usually we hear about 3 degrees of motion. Translatory motion along x-axis, y-axis, and z axis. What is the other extra 3 degree of freedom? And those extra 3 degree of freedom are the rotations about the x axis, y axis, and z axis. Together, we have 6 degree of motion the user will undergo, and all that will be captured into computing the position vector, velocity vector, and the orientation vector. And orientation, for the beginners, this word may not be very familiar, so I just want to show this particular slide. You see a man is standing there, and certain coordinate axes are marked. On the right side picture, the coordinate axis remains the same, and the person is slightly tilted. You see, his orientation with respect to a particular frame of reference is now changed. This is in general can be about all three axes. And therefore, this is what we mean by the orientation or attitude. Now, we are not going to learn about guidance and control, but it is unfair if I don't mention about guidance and control at least one or two words, because NGC, it is generally called the navigation, guidance, and control, is the integral part of any rocketry or aerospace aircraft and allied applications. So what is guidance? Guidance is, you know, you have a target position and velocity state to be achieved at the end of the mission. It could be whatever be the mission. It could be injecting a satellite in spacecraft, or maybe enemy target, destroying an enemy target, and several other. The target position and velocity should be achieved in a least effort way, optimally. Safely and optimally, and that algorithm is an optimization algorithm. Normally, somebody would have heard about 2-point boundary value problem. Don't worry if you have not heard about it. So it is an optimization. What is control? The guidance gives which direction the vehicle has to be oriented in order to take the vehicle to the target position and velocity in the optimal way, for which the actual control, how it is implemented, steering of the thrust vector or your handle in a cycle, or I can give examples, but if somebody wants, you can give more examples. Otherwise, but the main point here, is when you do this control, you have to ensure that the particular user vehicle may have certain sensitivities, and those sensitivities should not be triggered the way you control, because the whole thing is a dynamic system, so you need to ensure stability. And that's what, hereupon we are not going to talk about guidance and control, we are only going to talk about navigation. There are the application areas. These areas are missiles, guided weapons, rockets, aircrafts, submarines, spacecraft. There is a small difference. It's not full navigation. It is the attitude part, which I was mentioning. The angular attitude part is very important for imaging, communication, and so on. So in that sense, spacecraft is listed here, not in the conventional navigation in terms of full position and velocity. That is even otherwise known. Maybe we can discuss later. Now you take, this is only a background building. You take a launch vehicle shown on the left side here. And I have shown this launch vehicle undergoes six degree of freedom of motion. 3 translation and 3 rotation about the 3 axes. And that motions are measured by sensors, gyroscopes, and accelerometers. And that goes as the input to the navigation. And navigation computes capital R is a position vector, and capital B is a velocity vector. and inputs that information to the guidance module. Guidance module is already told where you need to reach the target conditions, and it takes the actual position and velocity at each instant of time and the target conditions which have been already told to the guidance. It computes what is the correction angle, commanded angle, or the correction angle of the thrust vector to be reoriented so that the vehicle moves in the proper direction to achieve the required thing. The figure what is shown, so it is a closed loop system. Now here what is shown here is Earth, and a rocket takes off from this point. It climbs. When it reaches at this point, the R vector and the V vector meets the target conditions in order to be in a particular orbit. So a little bit of orbital dynamics is there that we are not going to deal with here. So some kind of a context I built around launch vehicle. It can be told in with reference to aircraft also. So now let's look at the type of navigation systems. You know, our ancestors have used star maps to travel the sea for marine navigation. And actually, the same principle has been now used to build star sensors or spacecrafts and other interplanetary missions to get the orientation information, the attitude information, to few arcseconds of accuracy. So this is not full navigation. In a sense, it is navigation. Inertial navigation. Navigation systems are built using inertial sensors. Note this particular stuff. We will be coming again and again. They are primarily the accelerometers, the gyroscopes, and a lot of computations are involved. And of course, this is in the modern day inertial navigation system. This computation is very heavy. Now we have powerful processors. The previous generation, we had a different kind of a inertial navigation system. Today, we are not going to talk later because for want of optimizing the time, I have left that particular part. Then we have the radio navigation system, like ground radar-based long range navigation called LORAN of US, distance measuring equipment, VHF omnidirectional radar used in airports, global positioning system, global navigation satellite system by Russians, this is by US, the COMBES and Beidou, and they started with the name Beidou and now they are calling it COMBES Chinese system, Galileo by the European. And of course, we also have a regional navigation system now renamed as Navica, and it is already operational as you are aware. So these kind of navigation systems are there. We are going to focus on this particular middle one. Of course, we have one more, the hybrid navigation system or integrated navigation system, where we can combine this, and we are not going to talk about this here. Later we see. What the course will cover, not today's lecture cannot cover the entire thing. 1 hour is too small to talk about the entire thing. But the total course series will cover primarily inertial navigation algorithms, that algorithms for navigating in inertial frame. This is called Earth-centered inertial frame. And Earth-fixed rotating frame, Earth-centered, Earth-fixed frame. Local geographic frames, which moves, that is, which rotates and translates, particularly used for the aircraft navigation. And then I'll talk about inertial sensors, aeroscopes, accelerometers, and gravitation modeling. This is a very important thing. It will come again and again. Then initial alignment. Initial alignment, nothing but knowing the initial attitude of the user vehicle. Now, let's quickly see the advantages of an inertial navigation system. It's a very high accuracy, not for very long time, short to medium duration. There are reasons for that, we will discuss later. And it gives a very high bandwidth, high rate output, totally self-contained. It doesn't depend upon anything from outside. No aiding is required from outside. It is self-sufficient system. It does not radiate, it doesn't radiate. And you cannot jam it also. From outside radiation, you cannot jam it also. So that way it is an autonomous, cannot be jammed, fully self-sufficient navigation system. So what is the disadvantage? Disadvantage is, we already heard about accelerometers. See, they may have a small bias, acceleration bias. And to get position, you have to integrate that acceleration two times. One time to get the velocity and the second time to get the position. And if you do this integration for long duration, even a small bias error will lead to a very large position and velocity errors over a period of time, but over long periods of time. And that is the main disadvantage. Now, if we look at the inertial sensors, we have gyroscopes, accelerometers. I already told about it. Then a navigation frame, coordinate frame, we said, Earth-centered, you may have a inertial frame. What is an inertial frame? It's non-rotating, non-accelerating. Coordinate frame is an inertial frame. So different frames are there. Aircraft, it is different. A launch vehicle, it is different, and some other applications will be different. Gravitation computation, you require extensive gravitation model, mainly because the accelerometers that we use cannot measure gravitation. And immediately you may have a dispute in your mind on hearing this statement. I will explain that later. And that's a very interesting stuff to see. The gravitation vector cannot be measured by accelerometer and therefore needs to be computed using a model. So those models will be discussed later. And the computation algorithm, which depends specifically on the chosen navigation frame. If you are choosing inertial navigation frame, the computations are one particular type, and the most simplest is that. And if you choose the Earth-centered Earth fixed frame, which is a rotating frame along with the Earth's rotation, and the computations are different. And if you are taking a local geographic frame, the computations are going to be different. And gyroscopes, what are the different types of gyroscopes? The earlier mechanical gyroscope, there are many varieties. The latest high accuracy mechanical gyroscope is the dynamically tuned gyroscope, they call DTG. Then you have the laser gyros, two types, ring laser gyro and the fiber optic gyro. Both of them operate using the same principle, Sack-Nag effect. And then the MEMS technology has grown from the Coriolis vibratory principle is effectively used for the MEMS gyros. And for all of them, the range, the accuracy, bandwidth, resolution is very important. And for our class of aerospace application, the dynamically tuned DTGs and laser gyros are widely used. MEMS gyros are yet to reach that level of accuracy. And what about the accelerometers, a pendulous rebalance accelerometer? Different types are there, but all of them are pendulous rebalance accelerometer. That is why only one statement there. Range, accuracy, bandwidth, resolution, etc. are important. This we said, different frames. ECI stands for Earth-centered inertial. ECEF stands for Earth-centered, Earth-fixed frame, which is a rotating frame. Whereas the first one, ECI, is non-rotating, non-accelerating frame. So that's why it's an inertial frame. Then local geographic frame could be NED, north, east, down, ENU, east, north, up, I'll show you specific figures for that and explain. Then we need to do coordinate transformation. Why we need coordinate transformation? The user may be, let's say, a launch vehicle, has got three axes, X, Y, Z, and the sensors are tied to the body. We can't strap down. Sensors are strapped down onto the body axis, and all the measurements that are taken are in the body frame. And if you are navigating in ECI, Earth-Centered Inertia, these measurements taken in the body frame, body axis, need to be transformed to the ECI for taking decisions. That is why the transformation, coordinate transformation, comes there. That is one of the major elements in this navigation, coordinate transformation. Then attitude representation. How do we represent attitude? We have heard, you know, all of them, direction, cosine, matrix. DCM, everybody would have heard direction, cosine, matrix. Euler angles, I don't know whether you have heard. Quaternions, you might not have heard. It's an extension of the complex number. It is a very, very interesting, and this is the one which is very robust and being used. We will discuss a little bit of quaternion algebra, not in this lecture, later in due course of time. Then attitude propagation. So if you take a user vehicle, it continuously rotating and translating. Therefore, the body frame is undergoing continuously changing with respect to the inertial frame. For example, if we are doing navigation in inertial frame. So how to keep track of the continuously changing coordinate transformation matrix with time? Because the body frame is continuously rotating and translating, and that requires attitude propagation algorithm to ensure required accuracy and compute, of course, with the reasonable computation load. Of course, the last point has been already told. So these are some of the frames. We are straight away going into the frames. Let's see this frame. See, the figure is very self-explanatory. We have the x-axis going through the Greenwich meridian, and z-axis is the polar axis, the rotation axis of the Earth, and y-axis makes the triad. Here, one important thing I must say, that we have the right-handed coordinate system. When I say right-hand coordinate system, X, Y, Z is said right-handed if X cross Y gives Z and Y cross Z gives X, and Z cross X should give Y. And such a system is a right-handed system. And also you can see here in the Z axis, there is the rotation arrow is shown. So this is the convention of positive rotation about this particular axis. You take an arrow like this, hold it on your right hand, your fingers will be wrapping in the direction of the positive sense of the rotation, and your thumb should point to the direction of the arrow, and that is the positive sense of rotation. And you know that the Earth rotates approximately 50 degrees per hour. And here we have an fixed to the Earth, the X, Y, Z is fixed to the Earth. That means this frame is actually rotating with the Earth rate of 15 degrees per hour, okay? And this frame is used in the global positioning system. They are using this particular frame for navigation. Now you take little bit of imagination, I would request from all of you. Earth-centered inertia. We said, what is an inertial frame? It's a non-rotating, non-accelerating frame in which all Newton's laws are valid. That you should remember, Newton's laws are valid only in an inertial frame. Once the frame is accelerating or rotating, those laws are not applicable directly in that frame. So we are having here a Earth-centered inertial frame. The same figure I have shown here. And now, suppose I start my navigation at time t equal to zero, t zero. At that point, where this Greenwich meridian was and this x-axis was, at the instant of t zero, I will keep my x-axis from that time onwards. I won't change that x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis. I'll freeze it. I will freeze it in time and space forever. And Earth will be rotating, but those axes will remain fixed there, non-rotating, non-accelerating. And that is Earth-centered inertial frame. Hope I have explained. Now, is this really an inertial frame? Is a question. So it's not purely inertia. The reason being is that all of you know that Earth itself makes a revolution or goes around the sun. It is in an orbit of sun. That means with sun as the center, Earth is accelerating towards the sun. But that value of the acceleration is very, very small. In terms of some micro g, few micro g, that can be ignored for all practical purposes, practical systems. In that sense, the ECI is an inertial frame. But this is only, again, to create imaginative mind to people. The same figure can be used to explain both Earth-centered, Earth-fixed frame, as well as Earth-centered inertial frame. So if you keep this x-axis, y-axis, z-axis fixed to this Earth and rotate with it, it becomes Earth-centered, Earth-fixed frame, which is a rotating frame. If you keep this x, y, z frozen in space and time at the start of navigation t0, and then you allow the Earth to rotate, and then the axis would remain there in space. You have to only imagine, or you have to really imagine. In that case, it is a Earth-centered inertial frame. Now, coming to the local geographic frames, I think this is one of the most complicated frames, and this is used by aircrafts. For example, you take, if your aircraft is at this point or just above this point, there is a local north and local east and local vertical down. And that forms the axis at that particular point of time. And NED sequence is told because N cross E should give me a right-handed system down. And E cross D should give me north. And D cross M should give me east with a right-handed coordinate system. Now, assume that if your aircraft is already moved and reached this point, the local north is like this, and local down is like this, local east will be like this. So, this particular coordinate frame, the local geographic frame, rotates in a very funny way, and the origin also moves along with the aircraft. So this axis system is translating along with the aircraft. The axes are defined at each location where actually the aircraft is. In fact, this is the frame that the aircraft navigation uses, inertial navigation uses. This is one of the very complex mechanization. We will be discussing all that. And another version of the same thing, you can have ENU. It essentially the same, similar. E, N, U should form a right-handed system. Again, it is the local geography decides what is up, what is east, what is north. It is the local north. Okay? Now, so far we talked about the frame in which we are navigating, different frames in which we are navigating. But now, some of the user vehicles let us take. Say, let's take one is example is aircraft. I told you the sensors are strapped down or tied to the body of the user vehicle earlier. So, for example, in this aircraft, x-axis is defined along this direction, along the nose, called the roll by convention. The right wing direction is y, is called pitch. That motion, this particular motion is called pitching of the aircraft, and this is called rolling of the aircraft. And this particular axis, down axis, belly down axis, is the yaw axis, and this particular motion here, this particular motion is the yaw motion. Now, the aircraft, the sensors are tied onto, the body, the x direction, y direction, and z direction, both gyroscopes and accelerometers. And the aircraft undergoes all sort of motion, translation, rotation about all three axes simultaneously. And this body frame to the navigation frame which we saw, let's say this is the navigation frame for an aircraft, and this also keep changing, because of the motion of the vehicle, and relating this frame at any instant of time to this frame where it is actually is there is a transformation matrix between the two. And keeping track of that transformation matrix is very, very important. And that is another major thing for the navigation. Let's take another user, which is a large vehicle. This is not a universal convention. This is a convention used in our place. You have the z axis defined along the body, along the longitudinal axis of the vehicle, and the x. Why X is called yaw and Y is called pitch. Of course, these names have been borrowed from the aircraft convention. But of course, there is no, and the shape does not have any similarity to aircraft because here there is a symmetry, but in aircraft, it is slightly different. So this is a convention that, body axis convention that we follow the large wing. Now let's quickly come to a see, you take a vector, you can see the vector, I hope, this particular vector. I take a vector, I have two frames, one on the left side I call simply I frame, just an arbitrary name for the time being, and on the right side I have called another frame called the B frame. Both are orthogonal frames. This is also orthogonal. This is also orthogonal. But they are different. They are differently oriented. And we have a vector here. I represent this vector in this frame as well as the same vector can be represented in this frame also. If I represent this vector in this frame, I get the V, the X component in this B frame, Y component in the B frame, and the Z component in the B frame. And what actually it is? It is this particular vector itself. But the same vector, if I represent in the left side this coordinate frame, then I get the components as BXI, BYI, BZI. The vector being the same, and the, when they are represented in different frames, their component values are different. And how to connect them? What is the relation between them? And that, my cursor. Okay, I'll use this. Look at this. See the matrix here, what I have shown, the first element is CXBXI, and that is the cosine of the angle between the XB axis and the XI axis. And here, the cosine of the angle between the YB, my cursor is not working, so YB as well as XI. And this particular cosine of the angle between ZB and XI. What I want to do is, I take my first component, multiply with this, I'll get how much of this first component VXB would contribute in getting my VXI. I take my second component and multiply with the second term here, and to get how much of that will contribute in VXI on the left side. And the third component here, and multiply with the third term here, and how much of that contributes to this particular term. In similar way, this is extended in the same way, and you get the relationship between the two frames you are getting. And this matrix is called the direction cosine matrix. Actually, it is the transformation matrix, which transforms the, suppose the B frame, I, for the convenience sake, I call it as a body frame, and I frame, for the convenience sake, I called an inertial frame, which in which I am navigating. Then this DCM matrix is a transformation matrix which can transform a vector in the body frame to the vector in the inertial frame. Okay. And this matrix is an orthogonal matrix, and it is an orthonormal matrix. And in this context, I have put a question here. What is the eigen? So this is a square matrix, and it has got eigenvalues, eigenvectors. What is the meaning of those eigenvalue and eigenvectors? How many eigenvalues will be there for an orthogonal 3x3 matrix? And correspondingly, eigenvectors will be there. And there are three eigenvalues for this orthogonal matrix. One of them is positive 1, because it is orthonormal. The other two are complex, and that eigenvector corresponding to the positive 1 eigenvalue is a vector which, when represented either in this frame or in this frame, the components looks the same. I repeat it because it's very important, the concept of eigenvector. See, this is only one particular vector I have taken for example. There can be infinite vectors like this in the three dimension space. Now, there is one particular vector corresponding to the eigenvalue of plus 1 for this particular matrix. My cursor is misbehaving. Okay. That particular vector either is represented in the B frame on the right side, or it is represented in the I frame on the left side. The components, X, Y, Z components are non-distinguishable. They are the same. Such a vector is the eigenvector of this particular matrix. And the corresponding eigenvalue is also there. And this one has, this particular thing has got a lot of applications in subsequent. So let us take quickly an understanding of this transformation matrix a little bit more elementary way. I have a X, so X, Y, Z axis, and I called it an old frame. That is, I started with this frame. And about the X axis, I give a positive rotation. This is by convention which I have defined initially. I rotate about this by an angle theta, so that my Y becomes Y dash and Z becomes Z dash. And they move in the Y, Z plane, and they are still normal to X. And now The resultant axis x, y dash and z dash, I call it a new frame. Then can we find out a transformation matrix which a vector represented in x, y dash and z dash, x, y dash and z dash to x, y, z. And that's what is shown here. Say my cursor is misbehaving quite often. I'm gonna better maybe down. Now you take the here, you take the right side, you see Vx. Vx, Vy dash, Vz dash. This is V stands for a vector component in the x-axis. Y dash, x, y dash, z dash is my new frame as per my definition here, as per my definition here. Now I take Vx component definitely because the x-axis has not moved. And therefore the Vx component has to come as Vx there. And the Vy dash component cannot have a component on the x direction because the y dash is still orthogonal. The y dash is still orthogonal to x because y dash is in the yz plane. Then you take vz dash component, and that also is having no component on the x direction because it is in the yz plane. So that is why you have 1, 0, 0, the first row. And let us, and that gives the x component in the old x, y, z frame, the x, y, z frame. Now let us take what are the y component. Now you take the y component, further again take vx, vy dash, vz dash, you take. Vx again does not have any component in the y direction because they are orthogonal, but Vy dash now you take. Vy dash has a small angle, so it is the cosine of Vy dash component into cos theta will become the y component. That is why there is a cos theta here. And you take the Vz dash, the Vz dash you take here. Now you see this angle, this axis minus y axis is extended on the left side, and this angle is 90 minus theta. The cosine of 90 minus theta is sine theta, and that is on the negative y axis, negative direction. That's why it is a negative sine theta. And the same argument we take to get the other terms. Let's at least one, we have three more, but at least this alone will complete. But to get the z component, you take the x component on the new frame. It does not have any component on the z because the z dash, z and z dash, where is it? The z and z dash, they are in this yz plane, and x axis is normal to this plane. And therefore, that will not have any component. That's why the first value here is zero. And look at the vy dash. A Vy dash component to the Z, we have an angle 90 minus theta. So cosine of 90 minus theta is sine theta. So the component of that onto the Z axis is to be multiplied by sine theta. And again, you take the Z dash component, and that Z dash component is making a small angle to the Z, and that is a cos theta. That is why this comes. So what is really this particular very simple matrix is a transformation matrix from the new frame, which is the x, y dash, z dash, to the old frame x, y, z. So, and here I have shown, if you give a vector direction, a rotation in this sense is always positive, that is by convention. So here a vector in the old frame, that is xyz, is equal to the transformation matrix from new to the old into the vector expressed in the new frame. Now, similarly, cursor has misbehaved. Okay, now let's take this example where as a rotation about the y-axis is taken here by an angle psi, Now the z axis goes to z dash and x axis goes to x dash. And the new frame is x dash, y, z. Then you rotate about y, y doesn't change, the other two will change. And the old initial frame is x, y, z itself. And the same argument what we have made for the previous discussion, you can very simply write this matrix, which will transform a vector represented x dash in x dash y z dash frame to the x y z frame. Similarly, if you consider a rotation about the z axis and this kind of and call that angle as phi, and you get a transformation matrix like this. Now, suppose I have, now I'll explain those individually what will happen to that submatrices. Now, suppose I call my initial frame or the old frame as I frame, inertial frame, and then the final frame x double dash, y double dash, and z double dash as my body frame. And if I consider the initial rotation of theta angle about x axis and the second rotation psi angle about the resultant y dash axis, and then the third rotation phi angle about the resultant z axis, you will end up in x double dash, y double dash, and z double dash. And you have achieved from the moment from the I axis, the inertial axis, the inertial frame to the body frame by three defined sequential rotations about the three frames. And these three angles define that coordinate transformation matrix. And they are called the Euler, angles. And this is one way of representing coordinate transformation. And there are issues with this. And if you want to, this we have already seen that about the x-axis, if you rotate, what will happen? The right extreme matrix. Then y-axis if we rotate the middle one, z-axis if we rotate the leftmost one, you take the product of this, you get the total transformation from the B frame to the I frame. That is the B frame, the new frame that we are in, or you call now as the body frame, and I frame, that's your navigation frame, the inertial frame, you call it like that. So you get the total transformation matrix from body frame to the inertial frame. Now, how to get the transformation matrix I frame to B frame? Because the whole thing is an orthogonal matrix, you simply take the transpose of this particular matrix, you get the other one, because they are, because this is an orthogonal matrix. And these three angles, theta, psi, pi, are called Euler angles. And they are sequence of rotations, and that sequence of that sequence is very, very important. First, once you define about first angle about x-axis, then y-axis, z-axis, we should always keep on to that particular convention. Then there is no issue. Now, so this is only to give a small feel of the transformation, coordinate transformation, and what significance it has got is only a feeler, and we will be touching upon more details in other. Now, yet another important thing is the difference between gravity and gravitation. We study in the school and college, but then for navigation engineer, is the difference is very, very significant. So what is gravity? Normally what we call gravity. See, the gravitation is given by G mod m2 by r square, where this G, I have written it in a funny way, that this is the gravitation constant and this is Newton's gravitational equation. And that gives the gravitation. In this figure, and this I have shown here, the GI, I is in the inertial frame, the G vector, the gravitation vector represented in the inertial frame, this vector. So you are here and you are pulled down along in this direction with a certain value. And that, assuming the Earth is not rotating. Now, suppose Earth is rotating, suppose Earth is rotating and with certain angular velocity, you have a centrifugal acceleration, and that centrifugal acceleration is a vector depending upon where you are, which acts on you, and you get a centrifugal acceleration. In order to show it is centrifugal, the negative sign is used, and the vector sum of these two is the resultant, this red line, and that is this small gi, and that is your gravity. That is your gravity. This is what we usually talk about. The gravitation is the first one, and that is g m1 m2 by r square, where that g is the gravitation constant, because both g are coming, don't confuse like that. This is gravitation, this is the centrifugal vector. The vector sum of these two is the gravity vector, and in navigation we want this gravitation separately without this one for mechanization of algorithms. Now, you just see that. Suppose I have the gravity vector like this, you make just the opposite, you negate the sign of this particular one, negate the sign of this particular one, and then add it to the gravitation vector, then you get this one. The magnitude is same as the centrifugal acceleration, but the sign is reversed. You see, this vector is pointing towards the center of this local circle, and it is a centripetal acceleration. And that is, this is what in the school we study, that there is a uniform circular motion, the acceleration is towards the center, and that is this stuff, okay? Now, I don't know time, how am I narrating, 9:53, or 4:53. Now, let's take, in navigation, we have, my cursor has misbehaved, so please kindly, excuse me for that. See, I have what you call specific force, which is nothing but the measurable inertia force. I am explaining that. Now, this particular portion, please carefully see. I have a very crude representation of a pendulum with a small hinge here, put it kept in by some mechanism. How it is kept in the horizontal position, don't worry about that. That is the job of the person who is making the accelerometer. Later, when we study accelerometer, we can study that. Now, it is kept in the null position. Suddenly, suppose there is an acceleration coming in the up direction, the pendulum will start moving in the down direction. This is nothing but, suppose we are sitting in the bus, and the driver is accelerating the bus in the forward direction. The inertia force will act on you, and you will get pressed backward. And suddenly he puts up a brake and you go forward. Actually, what is shown here, it is nothing but that simple thing only. But then, and that is what we call the inertia force, measurable inertia force is the specific force. And that can be called as acceleration also. Now, suppose, what do we say? Earlier I said, if you remember, This accelerometer cannot measure gravitation. The gravitation need to be computed using a model. Why it cannot measure gravitation? Because assume in the ground, if I keep it, the pendulum will come down. That is a special case that we will discuss later. Assume I drop this from a 100-story building down as it is without any rotation. The whole body as well as the pendulum will remain as it is. There will not be any relative deflection of the pendulum with respect to the body. Unless there is a relative deflection of the pendulum with respect to the body, it is not measurable. So that is why, even though the pendulum is really falling, and at that time the gravitation acceleration is happening, but pendulum says, I am not feeling anything. I have no deflection, so I cannot measure it. So actually, it can be explained in different ways in the physics, but we don't have the time to do that kind of very interesting. So basically, understand that this accelerometer cannot measure the gravitation. So gravitation requires the separate model for that. The pre-fall I just explained. Pendulum will not have relative motion, I said. So, but for navigation, we need this gravitation vector. And therefore, we need extensive models, accurate extensive models. And again, this is a function of, this gravitation vector is function of position. So you need to know the position vector, then you can compute. Now just look at the principle of how a mechanical gyroscope works. Very simple. I think you would not have seen in any textbook this. This is my own diagram. And I draw one x-axis and a y-axis. Along the z-axis, I put a momentum vector. What is a momentum vector? Momentum vector is a moment of inertia, into angular velocity, angular acceleration. Similarly, we say, momentum. So, inertia into angular velocity is momentum. Now, the H1 vector is a momentum vector. There is some rotor which is rotating, which is having certain amount of moment of inertia. The rotating certain angular velocity, and that gives certain angular momentum. And in this case, in this position, I am calling that angular momentum as H1. Now, I just give about the x-axis a rotation omega angular rate, radian per second. So that my H1 vector moves like this by an angle delta theta. And the new position, the vector is called H2, because magnitude is the same. The momentum magnitude is the same, but then the direction has changed. So the vector is different, so I call it H2. We just take the difference of the new momentum vector to the old momentum vector, and that will give you, you see, this is that new momentum vector H2, and this is minus H1, and the difference is the delta H, and delta H is the change in angular momentum. And that change in angular momentum, you see, it is orthogonal to both the x-axis as well as the z-axis. And this change in angular momentum delta H has happened over a period delta T, and therefore delta H by delta T is nothing but the rate of change of angular momentum and rate of change of angular momentum is torque. Rate of change of angular momentum is torque, and therefore the torque here is about this particular arrow, this about this axis. That means your entire the flywheel, suppose you are used to generate the momentum, will deflect about this axis in the positive direction of this way, in the direction I have shown like this. Actually, this is the gyroscopic effect, and nothing more is required. Precision and all those things need not be talked about. Implementing this in numerous ways in mechanical gyroscopes, and the whole thing can be written as gyroscopic torque T is equal to omega cross H. You can see the direction is also omega cross H is along this particular direction. And that is the principle of the mechanical gyroscope. Now, we have seen certain things like we need coordinate transformation. We need, in the translation, we have two components. We have specific force, which specific force and specific acceleration, which can be measured by a physical accelerometer, and which cannot be measured by the physical acceleration is the gravitation. That need to be computed using a model. For that, we need a good model and a lot of computations to do the navigation. So if you, I think time is up about 5. So I finish it up in another 5 minutes. So you just look at this figure, and you have the accelerometer outputs, 3 axes, x, y, z is coming. The angular rate about the x-axis, omega x, omega y, omega z is coming. And here you get the FB is the body measured accelerations. And here the body measured angular rates from the gyros. Of course, this is compensation. And using this body measured angular rates, you compute the coordinate transformation matrix from the body to the inertial frame computation. And that is passed down to this particular module, in which this acceleration is transformed to the inertial frame. This matrix into this FB will take this FB to FI. And then we need to add separately the gravitation vector, which cannot be measured. We add up that part. We get the total inertial acceleration, x component, y component, z component. You do one integration, you get velocity, and you the second integration, you get position, and your navigation is over. But of course, you require initial velocity, initial position, and initial attitude, we call alignment, initial alignment, that need to be inputted. Once that is done, the whole thing is automatic, and position, velocity, and attitude information will be flowing to you in without any problem. So I think we will stop at this point, because a lot of details are there which we will cover. You should pardon with me. I have not planned to cover. I have planned certain number of slides, but then it is not that the covering these slides is important, in my opinion. Whatever we cover should be reasonably. So actually, I have only some 3, 5, 10 minutes more is there, but I couldn't accurately calculate. So I hope that the explanation speed was optimal, or you can give that feedback, and we will continue this exercise. And this is only a introduction, a feeler of what is involved, what are the topic is about. And this can be learned by any branch of engineering. And one may wonder where electronics is coming. Electronics will come when you are building the accelerometer, gyroscope, mechanical engineers, electronics engineers, electrical engineers, everybody will come there. Of course, this algorithm is mathematician's job. So, of course, we are mathematicians as well, all the engineers. And therefore, it's okay. So, I think we'll stop today, because the time is up.
Good evening all. On behalf of ECE department, LMCST, I Sajida take this opportunity to propose vote of thanks. First of all, extend my most sincere thanks to the Almighty God for making today's webinar a grand success. I would like to express my gratitude to our principal, Dr. P.P. Mohanlal, for excellent presentation and making this webinar interesting and meaningful. Thank you, sir. I would like to thank our HOD, Professor Surya SR, for her moral support and guidance. Thank you, ma'am. Next, I may like to express my sincere thanks to Professor Jinju Joy, my co-coordinator, for her logistic support. Thank you, ma'am. I also extend my thanks to our student coordinators, Josmon SS and Vipin MK of 4th semester ECE, for their enormous cooperation for this event. Thanks, Josmon and Vipin. Last but not least, I would like to thank all the participants, students and faculties of various colleges. This webinar can be completed without your presence. So once again, thank you all.
You can announce the next Saturday 4 o'clock. This will continue.
Okay. Dear participants, I request all of you to fill the feedback form that we provided in the chat box before leaving, because certificates will be provided only those who complete the feedback form. Next section will be continued on next Saturday at 4 p.m. So any questions and queries, please?
We can take some questions now if I am very comfortable. Anybody wants to ask, you can ask. And you can post the
any questions, please write in your chat box.
Sir, I'm Johnson from Electrical Department. Sir, can you hear? Sir, I'm Johnson from Electrical Department.
Yeah, your volume is slightly very low volume. Yeah.
You have not mentioned about the reaction wheel and...
Sir, volume.
Yeah.
Sir, your volume is very low.
Sir, you have not mentioned about the reaction wheel and control...
So please write, sir, please write your question in chat box.
Yeah. Johnson asked the reaction wheel and...
Control moment gyro.
Yeah. So, sir, yeah, I tell that. See, the reaction wheel and control momentum gyros are angular actuators used in spacecraft for steering the angular motion of the spacecraft. It is nothing to do with navigation. It is a control actuator to give angular motion, steering the vehicle. But if you take a launch vehicle, steering of the vehicle is done by thrust vectoring. If you take an aircraft, the steering is done by deflecting the aero surfaces. So control momentum gyro and the other one, what is that? Reaction wheel are torque generating devices, pure torque generating devices, no translatory motion, used in spacecrafts, and they are a separate class, attitude control system. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody? No, this material will be stored, and when we go for the next lecture, I necessarily have to assume that certain things that what we have discussed today is made the basic foundation, a little bit of that, and some more is required. Unless you go through that and think about it, that's why 1 week time is available, and you think about that, don't take it very silly. For example, I said accelerometer cannot measure gravitation. That statement is $1 million statement. So please look at it very carefully. And there are, my own slide, there is a contradiction, I'm about to present, time is not there. Think about all those things. The transformation matrix is the crucial stuff. And please think about a little bit about this and come. And what we are making the assumption now is that we know the accelerometers are very fruitful to give my acceleration. Gyros give very accurate angular rate. That is the assumption made. And as we go on, when we complete the algorithm, we will get into how the accelerometer works, how that is mechanized, what decides the accuracy, and so on. What are the problems there? Gyroscopes, your laser gyros, mechanical gyros, what are the, how they work? And the details will go there. And then not only that, inertial frame, the equation mechanization I have not shown. That is to be shown in the next lecture. And then when we go for earth-centered, earth-fixed frame, a complication will start coming. And then when you go for the aircraft frame, that is the local geographic frame, the complexity is the maximum. I think that alone would require 2-3 lectures dedicated to that. There are so many things will come up. And therefore, I personally request every one of you to go through whatever was talked about. And this will be available, I hope, for your reference, this lecture. And then go through that and come prepared for the next lecture. Thank you.
Any questions? So can we wind up the section? Okay, thank you. Thank you all. Once again, thank you all. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye. Shall I close?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you.